Good morning, everyone. Thank you for the introduction. And, well, welcome to this huge crowd to learn about Khalifa and ODF. As you see, I am dog shooting today. I'm running Khalifa right now. So, if anything goes wrong in this presentation, it's of course our own fault. Khalifa, well, what was the big news in Khalifa this year? Who knows?
Was there anything?
Ah, come on. Yes, that was big news.
Yes. Must be something big.
It's related to this screenshot? Oh, well, shit, the title gives it away. I'm sorry. this is the old look of Khalifa. You see all the KDE4 stylings. And when I press this button, we will have the new look. Yeah? This is the file that's open is, of course, still the same. All the rendering code is still the same. It's just we have new widgets. And a fresh tile which fits nicely with the desktop environment. So, big news. Well, of course this was in January, but since last Academy, this has happened. Okay, well, a bit of history about Khalifa. I guess most of you know what's written here. It's a very old KDE project. It exists for more than 10 years, and it used to be called KOffice in the times when every project within KDE thought it was fashionable to start the project with a K, and now we still sound like a K, but it's written as a C, Khalifa, and yeah, it's based on KDE stuff, and it's very light and modular, which is why Nokia chose it at the time to run on their phones. I still have a phone which runs the Khalifa code, and I'm keeping it until it dies. I hope at some point there will be another phone which runs Khalifa Office. Yeah, so the title is ODF support in Khalifa, and this is a list of the different applications in Khalifa and what part of the ODF standard they support. So obviously Khalifa Words and Author, they are text-based, so they support the ODT file format. The spreadsheet Khalifa Sheets supports ODS. This presentation is an ODP file which is running in Khalifa Stage. And Carbon, which has dropped off the slide, is using OGG, so the graphics format, yes?
Well, what is Author?
Author is a different skin on the text part, on words, which focuses on writing novels.
Okay.
Yeah, and the most active user of it is sitting next to you. Dan told me yesterday that he still uses it frequently to write his fiction. So, yeah. Well, a quick reminder on ODF files. I guess many people here know this, but I'll just repeat it. ODF files, in the common way they are used, are basically zip files. You can just unzip them. And if you do that on the command line, or if you open them in Arc, you can see the contents. And the first file you see there is called MIME type, and that holds the MIME type of the particular file. And then you get manifest. The manifest is a list of all the files which are in the zip file, and it mentions how they relate to the rest of the document. The pictures are in there as normal files, so if you want to get a picture out of a text file or out of a presentation, you can just unzip it and copy it from there. So this is a difference with HTML, because HTML pages are usually spread across the web. They have different files and different servers, and so it's very hard to archive them and have one copy of a file which you can look up in the future and archive and open again faithfully. With HTML files, you just have to hope that all servers for which you included content are still available. And that's a big difference. And that's the advantage of having a zip container. Now, the MIME type file I mentioned earlier has actually a very funny use, because the first file in the zip cannot be compressed. And the reason for that is if you look at the binary content of the file, you can actually read the MIME type always. It's guaranteed that the MIME type starts at a particular offset, and then you can read it from there. And that's purely to help applications quickly determine what the type of the file is. Continuing in the course of how does ODF work, this is the file content XML, which is holding the main important part of your document, the text. And as you can see here, it looks a lot like HTML, except there's namespaces for everything. The most important thing here is Hello Academy, written in a paragraph, and the P is just the same as you would have in HTML. And the text, the office text here, that's specific because this is a text document. If we go to presentation, then instead of a text, you have a presentation here. And instead of just starting with your text, you have to define pages. So you have a page, and then a frame, and inside there you have a text box, and then a paragraph again. For who in the audience thinks, hey, this is news to me? At least one guy, two guys, yeah, three guys. Great, so you have learned at least something already. Now, Caligra and ODF are very, very tightly linked. Everything in Caligra is done with ODF. If you want to read a file which is not in ODF, then what Caligra will do, the first thing is convert it to ODF, and then it will read it. And then when you save it back, internally it will convert, save it as an ODF file, and then convert it to whatever you want to have. So in that sense, Caligra is also a great toolkit for converting any file format from and to ODF. And there's a special command line utility for it, which is called Caligra Converter, which you can use for this. Now, where is Caligra in ODF? Where can you find it? Caligra has many libraries. It's a very modular application, which it's using this modularity to great advantage, because if you have a text in a presentation, it will use the same code as the text in a normal text file, and in a spreadsheet, if you have a frame there with text, it's also using the same code. And this is different for Microsoft Office, and it's also different for LibreOffice, because those applications, they grew together from different code bases, and they had different ideas about, for example, what text is. Whereas Caligra, from the ground up, treats all of these things which are the same in ODF as with the same code. So it's very well designed, actually, to deal with ODF. Now, the main library for ODF is called KO, K for KOffice, and KStore, KO Store. The KO Store basically does the unzipping, and the XML parsing, and the KO ODF then handles all the styling and makes the ODF part easily accessible to the code which comes next, which does the reading and the writing. Now, throughout the Caligra code base, there are pieces that display different parts. You can have bookmarks, you can have formulas, graphs. All of these are small classes with components in them, and nearly all of them have a function called loadODF and saveODF. And they get sort of the part in the ODF where we are reading at that point, and then they can continue from there. And when they're saving, they save into this function. Now, the signature of this function is not exactly the same everywhere. Sometimes you need some context in there. But generally, the first argument will be a KO XML element, which is like a DOM object. And when saving, it will be a KO XML writer, which is just a sync where you just write your XML tags into. So if you know one part of reading and writing XML or ODF in Caligra, then basically you can deal with all of them. So throughout the code base, this is really nicely uniform, and that's why if you can work on Caligra words, it's fairly easy to also start working on stage. Now, ODF is a standard. It's maintained by OASIS, and KDE is also involved in that. David Farrow, who is sitting there, was our first representative, and he also helped a lot in writing the standard. I took over from him, and Caligra Boeman, who is now our representative in the ODFTC, took over from me. I am still on the TC, but not for KDE anymore. I now represent the Dutch government there. And we are working currently to go to ODF 1.3. And it will be a minor release with cleanup. No sooner.
The UK government have anybody on that report? The UK government have standardized on ODF. Do they have anybody on in a similar position to you?
No, they don't. No. I know some people within the government of, what's the MP's office called again? Cabinet office?
Yeah.
Yeah, so some people within the cabinet office were really active on that, but they were very busy with migration, and so they didn't feel like they had the time to join the TC. But I should keep pestering them about it. It's a good thing to join for them as well. Yeah, it would be. Of course, other organizations could also join. If Scotland wants to join themselves, they could also do that.
Next year.
Next year? Okay. We'll talk next year.
Right.
Yes?
Is there any time for ODF 1.3?
No, when it's done.
Okay.
Yeah, we don't have the time for it. So what happens in between, until ODF 1.3 is ready, we see that different vendors have seen that there are limitations on the ODF format for them, and what they can do then is have an extension on the format, so they can have their own namespace and say we would like to have this feature, and that's allowed in the standard. So the two versions of ODF, ODF Strict, which doesn't allow extensions, and then you have the version with extensions. Caligua always saves a version with extensions, but it only has a few extensions. LibreOffice has a lot of extensions, but there you can configure LibreOffice to save with or without the extensions. Now, we have a standard. Does it work the same everywhere? No, it doesn't. So, not perfectly. Here's an example of a cool feature where Caligua does something which nobody else can, so that's why I'm highlighting it, of course. And that's wiggly text through, wiggly line through a text. So, there's a wiggly line through the top text, and LibreOffice, Adobe Word, Google Docs, Microsoft Office, they all have a straight line. So, if you use a lot of wiggly text, then you have to stick to using Caligua. That's the message here. I guess. How this is done, I was mailing to Camilla about this, is very Qt related, in fact, because most of the text rendering is just a Qt text document, but also that doesn't support the wiggly lines. So what Caligua does is it just renders normally and then does post-processing on the rendering by adding this wiggly line ourselves. So it's a wonderful, unique feature, and I suggest everybody to use it a lot. But so if you start testing more things in a more systematic way, then what you have is a plugfest. We have a plugfest about once a year where the different vendors come together and we look at how well everything interoperates. And every year we try to improve this. Here you see the number of issues. The last time we actually put a count on it, and we saw that Caligua had like 30 issues loading and saving, which was fairly good. LibreOffice is 29, so about the same. The only one which was better was WebODF, but that's a bit cheating because WebODF doesn't actually convert the ODF. It just reads it and writes it back. So the errors for WebODF are all rendering errors, whereas for the other applications, it's also quite often that when you load something and you save it back, you may lose a bit of information. But yeah, this is interoperability, and we have to work on it. Yes?
I remember that one of the major issues when I was in the TC was spot removal paragraphs, because basically LibreOffice does it one way, and Caligua was doing it another way, and the only conclusion we came to was let's have both in the standard, which sucks because in terms of interoperability, it requires everyone to support both.
Yes.
Yes,
that was a very good decision, to be honest.
No, it wasn't.
And we're phasing out one of them.
The number of paragraph.
Yes, the number of paragraph doesn't work well anywhere, except for the one, I think.
So it's not part of these results?
It's not in these results, no. Because these results were actually when we were focusing on styling, so, and the number of paragraph is a body element.
Yeah.
Okay. So that wasn't in this results. Here's a nice tool which I have developed last year to compare rendering of files. You can go to a web page, upload a document, and then see the differences in rendering. And I also have this live on a page here. So here you can compare how Calibre and Microsoft Office render this page, and you see that the graphics are really bad in Microsoft Office. It's only black and white, unfortunately. But if I compare this to, for example, Abbey Word, that's much better. We have a small shift in the font, but apart from that, it's quite nice. And the same when we look at LibreOffice.
So these are images that have been uploaded?
This is an ODT file which was uploaded to the server, and the server has a number of helper virtual machines, and we send the file there, and they give us back a PDF. And then we could, here this is a PNG for display purposes, but you can download all the files here. So here, if I want to look at the Calibre PDF itself, I can just click it. And this, so this is the created PDF.
So all of the implementations have an automated way of converting an ODT to a PDF, basically.
Yes, all of them do. Yeah. Yes?
How do you know which is correct or which is better?
Well, that's why we have we don't. This is basically to see that there is a problem. Yeah. And when you have this, then comes the next step, which is the next part of my presentation. So, yeah, this is the view from Microsoft Office. So what we would like to have is to create tests. Actually, the tests which I'm going to show here are about content when loading and saving. So we don't have any tests for the rendering yet. But if there was to be a disagreement in rendering, we would have to create a test which says, okay, I know exactly how this is supposed to be rendered, and I can create an SVG mask for this. And then the image plus the SVG mask should be, for example, completely white. That would be a way to test rendering. We have some preliminary code for that, but not on the server. And then you can make tests to do rendering quality, but we don't have those yet. But this tool is just to have a quick view and to also have a sort of majority vote on what is the good rendering. Right? If in this case only Microsoft was black and white and all the others had color, so then I can assume, okay, probably the others were right. Now this part is pretty cool and also requires a bit of a live demo. When you upload documents, what you can do is go back on page. So you can upload documents, then you have these files here. You can click on view, then you go to the slider view which we just had, or you can say make a test. And when you go to make a test, you have to create a name for it, like Academy, and then here we have an XML editor, and then we have something I'm really proud of, with auto-completion. So we have parsed the entire RelaxNG for so the schema for ODF, and yeah, we use it here to do auto-completion. And it even has validation. So I have a header here. But it says it's wrong. Now who can tell me what's wrong here? This is for the ODF experts. What's wrong?
It's empty.
It's empty, okay. Hello. Still wrong. Okay. It's maybe not very...
H1's at the level?
Yes, the outline level is missing.
It's like H1, H2, H1.
So... is that true? Fail to validate. Okay, the error message is not completely useful, but if I add the outline level. Oh, sorry. Ah, still wrong. Okay, let's put a number. Yes, that was better. So I can write a very small snippet of ODF. And if you remember the examples from earlier, there was much more XML. That's because we allow people to just write a small snippet, and then this dialogue knows where to put it in an ODF file. And then you can write a small test here and say, when I save this file and I load it again, I should still have one heading, and it should have outline level 1. So you can write a small fragment of ODF, add a test to it, load it, save it, load it back again, and then you can see the results. And here's an example of a result page. So let's scroll up a bit. We had an ODF file, this is the input file, I can click on it to download it, and it had no validation errors, and these are the tests I wrote for it, these are all true, but then when I saved it, I loaded it with every word, there were validation errors, and the content which I wanted to feed was actually gone, so that was not so good. Same with Google Docs, WebODF kept it, and yeah, you get to hear the whole list of applications. A few of them haven't finished running yet, unfortunately. And so you get an overview of who is passing the test and who is failing it. And these numbers here, or these dialogues, are for people who have an account. They can actually confirm that the test is correct in this assessment. So it doesn't automatically go to a big report, but people, experts, still have to look at it and say, yes, this test is actually correct, it is gone, and it's a bug in this application. Okay, yeah, so on a screenshot, there's a fallback with the same thing. And here below you can see the PNG files, or you can download the PDFs. Another convenient thing here is that if you want to look at one of these ODF files, this one, then it will show you a page where you can download it, but you can also just click on all the contents of the XML. So if I want to see the thumbnail, which happens to be empty here, or I want to look at the settings XML, you can just directly go into those files, which makes it very convenient to investigate things. You don't have to unzip everything on the command line or whatever way you would normally do that. Okay. Something else. Of course, no, we've seen. Yes? Was that a question or just feeling tired? Just feeling tired. Okay. well, so we've seen there are some bugs, also in Caligra. Well, how can we fix them? We need to develop. So this is a small interlude, which is also a preview to a talk that Jonathan will be giving later today. Oh, it's tomorrow, yes. You have to be even longer, so all the better that we have a preview now, so you can be anxious for a long time, and you can try it out already. Basically, Docker is a wonderfully nice new technology, which allows you to very quickly run an application on the Linux in a container. And it's almost as fast as the application would normally be, but you are in an environment which you can dictate. So if you're developing Caligra, what can happen is that you need to install a lot of plugins, you need to tell the KDE environment about them, and this might interfere with your normal environment. So what you can do for that is you can do all the development in a Docker container, and here I have shown a command line that lets you quickly go into a KDE Neon Plasma development environment, and from there you can start installing the compiler and the dependencies for Caligra. Or you could also write your own small Docker file, and Docker files are really easy. It's just a few lines here. So the first line is, what is your starting point? So I can start from the KDE Neon Plasma development stable image, and then as a user root, I want to run this apt-get command just to install my dependencies. Then I switch back to use the Neon, and that's it. If I do that, and then I run Docker build, then I have an image with which I can very quickly go into a nicely contained Caligra development environment And in there, I can mount my local directories as well. So you can do the git commit and checkout in your normal environment and have all the source files available in your Docker image. Here's a screenshot from my laptop where I was developing Rich Qt Creator in Caligula 2 and Caligula 3 at the same time. You see them running at the same time in different virtual machines, but the windows are just in my normal Plasma environment. Yes, and when we fix the lot of bugs, we can get good scores on the next OEF Plugfest, which will be in October in Rome. And I'm looking forward to it. This was announced yesterday, actually. Well, it was known for a bit longer that it was coming, but this beautiful image was only mailed to me yesterday. And yeah, I'm really looking forward to the next Plugfest. Yeah, if you want to validate your OEF files, there's a validator online. I probably should skip that, I don't know how good I am in my time, but here's another image from Carbon, and this might be a nice challenge for this academy. Carbon can open and save SVG files, but when I try to open this logo, I got this background displaced by some amount. It's probably an easy fix, and I think that it would be great if Carbon could be a good competitor to Inkscape. Because to have, we could, I think we should give it.
Illustrator. Hmm? Illustrator first.
Well, okay, Illustrator.
Why not?
Why not? Yes. Let's set the size high. Anyway, this might be a nice bug for somebody to tackle if they want. And that's the end of our talk. I'm open for questions now.
If you have any questions about this talk, we have a coffee break now.
Yeah.
Now, sorry, yes, 5 minutes ago. So you can ask him in the coffee break. So sorry.
Okay, that's fine. It's not that much of a crowd. If you want any autographs or questions.